Right, so let's look at the JPEG format and especially the methods that JPEG uses to be able to compress our images. And what we'll find is that JPEG is much more matched to what our eye would actually see. Okay, so first we'll look at the JPEG process. So this is the process that we have for JPEG. Basically, we convert from RGB into our luminance, blueness, and redness. We then take what's called the discrete cosine transform to put it into a spatial domain. Then we look at quantization of the values and then on to some coding in the end. So the actual process itself really is fairly highly optimized and really tries to get the minimum size of each of the images. As we'll find when we look at motion video, really motion video is a whole lot of images actually put together as a stream. So it's important that we can get the images compressed when we look at motion video. Okay, so the first part is to convert into luminance and then our CB and our CR. So as we saw before, the green component has most influence on the luminance, red to a lesser extent, and then blue to even less extent. And then when we calculate the CB, we can see that blue has the greatest effect, and when we look at CR, it's red that has the most effect. Okay, so that's the conversion that happens. And what we probably need to do, or what we need to do, is make sure that the luminance is actually fairly well defined because our eye is fairly sensitive to changes in brightness and less so for small changes in color. So the second part of the process is what's called the discrete cosine transform or DCT. So there's the mask there if you're interested. But basically what it does is that it analyzes, in this case, four 16 different components. And the components go from 0, 0 to 8, 8 down there. And each of the components is analyzing a certain characteristic of the spatial frequency. So the components that go down this way are analyzing for the horizontal changes, and the ones that go across this way are analyzing for vertical ones. Okay, and they're really trying to match against each of these components. So what we do is that we take the image and then we split it up into these pixel blocks. So the pixel blocks are 8 by 8 pixels, or they could be 16 by 16. And then the 8 by 8 pixels are obviously converted from RGB into this YCBCR. And then we take each of these pixel blocks and we feed it through this transform to give us our spatial analysis. So if we have a look at the link here, this should be able to show us a few examples. Okay, so this is some example pixel blocks that we might have. Okay, and what we have on this page is that it will calculate the actual DCT for us. Okay, so there's an example with some stripes. So we've got 0, 0, 0 for the top, and then the maximum intensity because we're using 8-bit color in this case, and then 0 again, and then maximum intensity. And that gives us our DCT. On the other end, when we're reading the JPEG back, we use an inverse DCT, and we should be able to get our values back again. Okay, so we should be able to try different values there. So you can see for our striping one, then it's matching across the top line there. But when we look at our horizontal one, values are matched to the column. Okay, and if we take a checkerboard pattern, we'll find that the strongest element is actually the one down the bottom here, and that's the one that's measuring the highest rate of change. Okay, so that's the DCT. So here's the examples that we have. So for our horizontal stripes, we can see here that it's matching this column, which are really looking at measuring the horizontal changes. And then this one here, you can see here, it's measuring across the top there. So that's for the vertical changes. And if we take a checkerboard, we'll see that we get a number of components, but the strongest one is obviously the one at the end there, and that's really relating to this one here, which is measuring the highest rate of change with inside the pixel block. Okay, so this is really the core of how much of our images and videos are actually processed. The next part of it is what's called quantization. So quantization basically takes these numbers that we looked at before, so these numbers here, and then basically just divides them by a certain amount. And if it's a large value, there's a very good chance that that the value will become zero when we divide it by it. If it's a smaller value, then obviously it will be reduced, but it's still a certain value. So with quantization, we look to possibly get rid of the high frequencies and get them below a certain threshold, and then cut them off to zero. So this is an example of our quantization. So if we quantize by 16, divide by 16, we see the resolution of the picture is still pretty good. But then if we use a quantization of 256, we see that we lose a lot of the detail in it. So can we get that link? Okay, so here's an example. So we've taken snapshot here. You can see this is off the nose here, but when we actually zoom in, we see a whole lot of these pixel blocks. So these are the small pixel blocks, and really there isn't that many changes with inside the pixel block. So what we should find is that many of the high frequency components with inside a pixel block can actually go, and what we get really is an average overall of the actual pixel block. That's the most significant thing, because you can actually see that it's the average value of the pixel block that really matters probably the most when we actually want to define the detail of the image. And your eye itself is really not that sensitive to changes in color, fast changes between the color. As we can see, we can really hardly see that if we actually look in the image. And we can use this method with inside face detection. So with face detection, what we often look for is areas of dark, light, dark. So we can see with the eyes here, there's some dark, light, dark there. We might also look at edge detection as part of that. So in face detection, what we try to do is to be able to look and process and threshold to be able to find certain things. So in this case, we're looking for eyes. So we'll just try and find eyes here. So this is looking for a threshold where we can actually find the characteristic features of an eye, which is dark, light, and then dark again. And we can also do the same thing with a smile. With the smile, what we're looking for is light, horizontal light, and then dark, and then light again. Okay, so this is detecting the smile around here. So the thresholding method is used fairly often with inside our image processing of faces. Then the last part, or the last two parts, is to be able to save the values that we have for our array in a zigzag manner. Okay, so this helps to optimize the runs of zeros that we have. Okay, so if we look at after we've quantized, we end up with a whole lot of zeros over here, which aren't really that significant. So if we save it in terms of a zigzag pattern, then what should happen is that we'll end up with a whole run of zeros. So then zero length encoding is actually then used to say, well, I've got certain values and then I've got, in this case, 51 zeros. And we can use a very small code to actually save that. Okay, so this is really what happens with inside the last block, the zigzag, and then the run length encoding. So now let's look at what the JPEG format actually looks like. So a key feature of it is that we have FFD8 at the very start of the file. And then we often have a header that actually defines the metadata with inside the JPEG. So we can actually see what the camera was and so on. But along with this, there are various tags with inside the JPEG image. In this case, FFB8DB, C4, and so on. And then also with inside the processed image, and we have Huffman coding. And Huffman coding, we've got to watch not to confuse the system. So we add in an FF00. So as we process through the file, we should be able to see lots of these FF values actually appearing. So let's have a look to see if we can get an example here. Okay, so this here is our image, and then here's an FFE0. And if we actually search the file, we should see lots of these FF00s, FF00, FF00. And we actually find within a JPEG virtually every segment that we look at, every 512 byte segments, has at least one FF00. So that's often a sign, actually, if we look within inside our disk, if we can see FF00, there's a good chance it's a JPEG file. And we can actually even process our JPEGs here. So in this case, you should be able to see that we've taken the first 64 bytes and just written a small little Python program here. So all it's really doing is detecting when it's FF, and then it's looking at the next value and then matching that tag. And you can actually see that this image here has a whole lot of these stuffed values in it, lots of them. We take another image and we can see again. So I've stopped it at a certain number because it would go on for many occurrences. If you want, you can actually have a look at the forensics analysis of the image. So this is for this image here. And again, we see the FFD8. There's the camera information in there. And the other tags that we have, FFDB. There we go. Okay, so FFDB is here. Okay, so that's the format of JPEG. But the key thing for us is really the understanding of how the images are actually processed and how we can save a great deal of space. Because when we go on from images to video, we'll actually find that this processing happens, and the video often is just basically a whole lot of images played at a certain speed. Okay, thank you.